Hello and welcome to The Postcard Professor, where we take complex ideas and explain them in the space of a postcard.
In this video, we're going to be building the methodology to determine a stiffness matrix for a 2D solid. Now, this work is built off of a previous video where we found two equations through the Galerkin method. This first equation is based off of the sum of the forces in the x direction. The first term here deals with the tractions on the surface of our body. The second term deals with the body forces. And the third term is looking at the stresses and strains inside the surface. The second equation looks very similar. The only real difference is going to be the terms inside that vector of stresses and the direction of our body force. Now, as a reminder, our stresses here are related to our strains through a constitutive matrix, which we're not going to define in this video, but that is based off of whether we're talking about plane strain or plane stress, what assumptions we're making about the forces on our solid. And of course, these strains are based off of derivatives of our displacements. Okay, to start off, let's expand out this vector a little bit so we can relate it to our full vector over here. So we can do this just by adding in an additional matrix that pre-multiplies this sigma x, sigma y, and tau xy. So in order to make this multiplication work, we want our first row to be equal to sigma x. So that's going to be a 1 in this first location and zeros for the sigma y and tau xy terms. And then the second row is going to be 0, 0, 1, grabbing just the tau xy. And we can do something similar for this equation. Tau xy will be on top, and sigma y will be on the bottom. The second thing we could do is expand out this just a hair. So this is the gradient vector, which is d by dx and d by dy, multiplied by this psi I. So this is d psi I dx and d psi I dy, just in vector form. So if we want to expand this piece out, we can say that the integral of omega of that gradient of psi I dotted with sigma x tau xy is going to be equal to the integral of this gradient vector dotted with, and let's use just our x equation to start. This will be 1, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1. And instead of copying down these again, let's recall that these can just be written as our constitutive matrix multiplied by these strains. Now, these strains, we can expand. So we can say that this epsilon x, epsilon y, gamma xy is actually equal to a matrix of derivatives multiplied by our u and v displacements. Epsilon x is du dx, so we need a d by dx in this first location, nothing to do with y. Epsilon y has nothing to do with u, but it's the y derivative of v. And then gamma xy has both u and v components, but it's the y derivative of u and the x derivative of v. Another thing we could do is to perform this dot product. So a dot product takes the top element and multiplies it by the entire top row, and then adds that to the bottom element multiplied by the entire bottom row. And so in the end, we expect to end up with a 1 by 3 row vector here. So this will be equal to our integral over omega of d psi I dx, 0, because there's nothing happening there. And then on the bottom, we have d psi I dy. And then this d is not changing, so we'll just leave that alone. And then we'll plug in this representation for our strains. So let's dive in a little bit on this U and V. So we've already talked a little bit about the existence of these shape functions, but let's say for this case that we're going to have three shape functions, psi 1, psi 2, psi 3, and those are going to be acting on both U and V. So what we can do is we can expand out our U and V term to be equal to some matrix, which is then going to be multiplied by a vector of nodal displacements. We said this was going to have three nodes, so we'll have U1, V1, U2, V2, U3, V3. And so U should be psi 1 times U1, psi 2 times U2, and psi 3 times U3. So we can write that as psi 1, 0, psi 2, 0, psi 3, 0. And then V is going to be the same, but we're looking at V1, V2, V3, and so that ends up just staggering the position of those shape functions. So we're in the home stretch. In this next step, we're going to bring in the y equation. So far, this has just been the x equation that we've been developing. But if we apply this same step to this vector matrix dot product, then we can build something that looks a lot like this, but for the y equation. So let's start off with the x part. And then the y part will have a d psi dy in this position. And then the d psi dx will be in the third location. And then, of course, there's nothing in the first position. Our D matrix doesn't change. That's still a 3x3. And then what we're going to do is we're actually going to take this matrix here and multiply it by this matrix here. So we're going to perform that matrix multiplication. So to find our first column, we take the first column of our shape function matrix here and multiply it in turn by each of these rows. So this will be d psi 1 dx, and then nothing from this place, so we don't add anything. Then this is multiplied by 0 and 0, so that's just nothing. And then we have d psi 1 dy. Then for our second column, there's nothing in our first row. The second row has d psi 1 dy, and then the third row has d psi 1 dx. And this pattern is copied as we go through, just for psi 2 and psi 3. So we can write all that out without any issue. Now, this vector, we can multiply by that, but these are all constants, right? These do not change with space. There are nodal positions, so we can move those outside of the integral. Now, this vector of derivatives of our shape function, we're going to give a name. We're going to call this the B matrix. And what we can recognize is if we stack all of our equations for psi 1, psi 2, psi 3, then this vector here looks awfully similar. And in fact, it's just each of these pieces transposed. So if we stack all three of those, then we end up with B transposed. This vector, we already have a name for. That's just our vector of displacements, U. So the final form of this piece of our equation is going to give us our stiffness matrix, and that is going to be the integral over the domain of this B transpose DB multiplied by our vector of displacements. So this right here is exactly our stiffness matrix. Just to recap briefly, we started off looking at the results of the Galerkin method. Then we performed some matrix math to simplify this gradient of psi into something that can be reasonably multiplied in our matrix form. Then we expanded out our stresses using the shape function form of our displacements and multiplying by this derivative matrix. And that gave us this B matrix. We were able to recognize that this matrix, once we stacked three versions of it, is going to be B transpose. And since this entire thing is multiplied by our vector of displacements U, it's exactly the stiffness matrix that we need in order to build out our finite element method. So the next step is to determine the shape functions that we're using. We talked about building this on a triangle so that we only had three shape functions. But in reality, this method works no matter how many shape functions we have. So we need to determine what shape functions we're using and how exactly we're going to take the derivatives of those shape functions. So that'll be the topics of the next handful of videos. In any case, I hope this was helpful, and I will catch you next time.